These are serious times. I still smell nigger.
Tell him he's African American.
Listen, man, he's too important to the movement. His commitment is that deep.
No, actually, he has, unfortunately, has bone cancer and was not able to get clear for surgery, and so.
Yeah, that sounds like a terrible break for you. I'm sure that he would have been very proud of you.
Is that your dad?
Yeah, that's my dad.
This man right here is your father?
Did he just call us niggers? Awesome!
Right there?
You have a question about that?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
I was wondering if your dad really is an African American man.
That's I don't know what you're implying.
Are you African American?
Man, I am tired of that. I am not passing. I am black. Do you hear me, man? Do you understand? I am black. I'm a nigga. Do you understand me? I was born black. I live black. And I'm gonna die probably because I'm black. Because some cracker that knows I'm black better than you, nigga, is probably gonna put a bullet in the back of my head.
I don't understand the question. I did tell you that, yes, that's my dad. And he was unable to come in January.
Are your parents, are they white?
And what's your face? We want to see your face.
Yeah. Who said that? You want to see my face?
Wait, go on, brother.
You want to see my face? Don't be afraid, Jason. Don't be afraid.
Black skin has naturally excellent protection from the sun. White skin needs the extra help of a sunscreen like UV.
Mr. President, demographers tell us that in order to sustain itself, a population needs a birth rate of 2.1 live births per woman. In the whole of Europe, the only country that is reproducing at sustainability level is Albania, or Turkey, if you count Turkey as a European country. Nowhere else. Europe, including European Russia, is scheduled, according to one UN report, to lose 100 million people over the next 40 years. Germany alone is going to see a shrinkage of its population of 20 million. These are not projections about what might happen if we don't do something. There's nothing we can do about it now. The decline in birth rates has already happened. The only question is how we deal about it. Why did it come to this stage? What brought us to this pass? Well, one doesn't want to oversimplify. There's obviously a lot of things going on to do with changing working patterns, to do with the spread of contraception, to do with the different role of women in society, to do with longevity. But I wonder whether one part of the problem is the way in which the state has expanded and squeezed out the private sphere, has annexed to itself jobs and duties that were traditionally discharged within the family, childcare, education, social security. The first generation raised with cradle-to-grave welfare, in other words, to be excused the traditional responsibilities of adulthood, was also the first to give up on parenthood. And we now face a choice between demographic collapse or importing 100 million people to sustain our numbers and pay our pensions. This should be the top issue in Europe, and it's not one that we're going to address by arguing about changes in employment.
Now, our long-term goal is to be able to develop the technology to transport millions of people to Mars, which will preserve the future of humanity in the event of a calamity on Earth. I absolutely think we want to have a future where humanity is out there exploring the stars and where we have human civilization on multiple planets.
Resupply the International Space Station.
Darkness falls across the land. The midnight hour is close at hand. Creatures crawl in search of blood to terrorize your neighborhood. And whosoever shall be found without the soul for getting down must stand and face the hounds of hell and rot inside a corpse's shell. The demons squeal in sheer delight. It's you they spy, so plump, so right. For though the groove is hard to beat, yet still you stand with frozen feet. You try to run, you try to scream, but no more sun you'll ever see. For evil reaches from the crypt to crush you in its icy grip. The foulest stench is in the air, the funk of 40,000 years, and grisly ghouls from every tomb are closing in to seal your doom. And though you fight to stay alive, your body starts to shiver, for no mere mortal can resist the evil of the thriller.
Saying that the devil is the devil, ain't nobody that doesn't have a certainty that all white people and all Jews are going to be killed and that they're under divine judgment, tell them to stay the fuck away. Anybody that's upset about certain languages, tell them to stick that language up their motherfucking ass and go vote for the abomination in Washington. Tell them go for the abomination in Washington who's killing your children. Excuse me, you don't have children, you have kids, you have baby goats, you little black fucking Uncle Tom, Aunt Jemima motherfucking B.E.T. wig-wearing, cock-sucking motherfucking Negroes! Stay the fuck away!
Thank you.
when we're out in the sun, we're all at the mercy of Mother Nature. But think about it. To get the protection the black man has naturally, the white man needs a sunscreen like UV. So, Mother Nature must be black.
Hey, how's y'all doing? This is Mr. Blows Your Minds coming with another thought-provoking topic. Today's topic, man, I tell you, well, there's some stuff that's been going on lately, and it's just been, you know, just a firestorm of events that just seem to be materializing to some kind of design or some kind of end, you know what I mean? And so, for a lot of us who are out here who are trying to bring truth and understanding or have some kind of spiritual connection to transport information from the ethers, we need individuals like this in this time, because many signs and many quizzes and puzzles of these mazes need to be discerned. They have to be deciphered. And so, based on this video here, I want to bring out some of the events that have taken place in recently. And then as I'm starting to make this video today, there was a breaking news story based on at the beginning of this clip or beginning of this video. You see that I made the scenario based on the NAACP Rachel Dozier, right? And she's just stepped down. Now, to me, this speaks volume. I know there's a lot of our people out here who look at this scenario and says, well, what does color got to do with it? And if somebody's going to fight for justice, you know what I'm saying, more the merrier, right? And as I go through this dissertation, and I'm going to connect based on everything that had been seen prior to get to where we are right now, this video, I'm going to, you know, meticulously break down what all the segments of those clips were about. But I just think it's ironic that a woman, when you look at her credentials, right, her accolades are very extensive. Right, she's pretty much, you know, knows black from a erudition aspect of things, you know what I'm saying? Erudition meaning from an educational book learned, right? But she does not have the life experience aspect of it, which is, that's just like saying somebody who's only book smart and then throw them into a street scenario, can they survive? And how long could they survive once they become exposed that they're not really street savvy? Well, that's what looked like that happened here. See, you profess to love and to fight against the injustices, and this is your catalyst that drives your will. But the minute that fire turns on the heat, what do? You run. So, for myself, and I'm only speaking for myself, how does one who vividly tries to, you know, emit that energy that she is so rightly for the cause, and then the minute she's exposed, because, number one, we have to look at the simple fact that we understand that based on the manipulation, mind control, the hypnosis that white supremacy has done on both sides of this fence, a lot of people are confused. You have black women as well as black men who try to take on the persona of the other side of the fence, right? That has been more prevalent, and that is the thing that most people seem to look at, but it is kind of a silent you know, taboo. Nobody really wants to talk about that. We know it, but we don't really delve deep into it because of we understand the deep psychologicalness of what has transpired through our encounters with our oppressor. So when we see this aspect of the white person who has vicariously transformed themselves to be like, to become like, to act like, walk like, talk like, you understand? And then to ascend into a highest position in the organization, that when I get to that part, I'm going to break down something, because I didn't say our organization. If I did say our organization, I misspoke. A organization that seems to appear to be a black organization, when you look at it from the fundamentals or the foundation of it, it's just an organization that was funded by a particular individual who had an agenda. And I'm going to tie in this information to what I believe, as you've seen in the video, that it talks about darkness falling across the land, the midnight hour, which is Vincent Price, how this seems to be the direction that they're trying to move our people in towards, so that this plan, this agenda, this event that they want to make this cataclysm to clash, so that they can do what they're trying to do. I think this has a lot to do with it. And I think by her, you know what I'm saying, breaking the glass and getting out of there, she's running from the aspect of to be questioned about certain things. And I know there's a lot of people who are siding with her, but there had to be a motive for what she done. You understand? And because a lot of people try to throw that when they talk about 60s, and they threw this stuff to be something back in the past, and don't look at how things still tie relevant to this day. And that because of the organizing that black people had tried to commence, that infiltration became harder for those in opposition to be able to dwindle in. So if you can raise up one that can be educated, know it better than the average, because let's put it to you like that. If we was to look at her, matter of fact, her profile, right? Let's bring her profile up. I'm going to actually put this up on the screen here. Okay, now if we were to bring her profile up, right? And we'll see that she had a master's degree at Howard University. Howard being an HBCU, historical black college university, right? And so her foundation, starting off into her collegiate education, she went to a black university, right? She took and got her degree in what they call Africana Studies, right? She became a professor at Eastern Washington University, right? She taught African American art history, African American history, African American culture, the black woman struggle, intro to African American studies at Eastern Washington University. Her scholarly research focused on the intersections of race, gender, and class in the contemporary diaspora, with a specific emphasis on black women and visual culture. Her passion for civil rights was influenced by her years in Mississippi, which she advocated for equal rights and participated in community development. She is the former director of education at the Human Rights Educational Institute, a licensed diversity trainer, and a consultant for human rights education, inclusivity in the regional schools. Now, since during her experience as the director for the Human Rights Education Institute, Dozell developed programs and curriculum that expanded the annual audience from a 3,000 per year to 23,000 per year. She created world-class exhibits, coordinated cultural events, scheduled keynote speakers, organized panel discussions, became the young advocate for human rights summer training program. Her efforts were met with opposition by North Idaho white supremacist group, the Ku Klux Klan. So when you seen in the, if you've seen in the beginning when I showed the Chappelle clip, this is basically the reversal of that whole scenario. It's when he was what they call bigams, right? I think they call it, what was his name? The way that Chappelle depicted that scene was, here was a blind man who didn't know he was black that was in the Ku Klux Klan and was the prime advocate, was more whiter than the white person. So now we have the real life Miss Bigums, who is for a so-called, most people believe, as a black organization fighting against the injustices and, you know, discriminated practice, right? And she is a main advocate, but she is not the headquarter of NAACP. She's just in Spokane, but the fact that the organization, and she is coming across in blackface. You understand what I'm saying? And then, as we were reading her resume, what does she, as a white woman, know about black woman struggle? You understand what I'm saying? Now, she is speaking from the mind of the white individual of how they look and perceive against white people, which is very informative information. It is good things to know. Frances Cress Wilson said, if you want to know how good a white person is friends to you, ask them, tell me the things that white people say when black people aren't around. This is the point we could have gotten from her. This, I think, is what, in some way, she may have been doing if she was to be legitimate as into her what she proclaimed. If she proclaimed to be as true as she says she is, then why do you run the minute that it got hot? When you got exposed, if your work is generally supposed to be authentic, as black people, and if you study us and know us, the one thing is, by you authentically being a white person, bougie blacks and the people in the organizations and a lot of people who are participants and who fall under that leadership would have had no problem with following you. Is it because of the national attention that you were getting, and that the question would become, why did you have to go to the extreme to try to pass, as you've seen the clip where the cat was saying, he's tired of passing. I'm black. I'm a nigga. I'm born black. I live black. That's her. This is her. But the minute it got hot, now you jumping out the window. You can't see. This is what Stevie Wonder would say, a part-time lover. You know what I'm saying? We can't turn it off. You understand? When it get hot, we have to accept it 24/7, 365, every holiday, rain, sleep, snow, hail, earthquake, tornado, monsoon, it don't matter. We can't turn it off. But see, you got exposed. You truly got exposed for what you claim to be at the heart of who you believe and what you're advocating for. If you truly one of us, and you said that you understood all this stuff that you claim that you know that is wrong with the people who you are biologically connected to, why didn't you take the stance? Why didn't you take the stance? It's the question, y'all. Don't say, well, I'm stepping down so that I don't bring a blemish on the organization and keep the folk. That's already done. You're not going to be able to take that back. This is a topic that is spoken, but for people who have grown up, who have matured a little bit more as into the racial aspect of things, it's not as most people think it is. There's a question of what was the agenda. You understand? What is the agenda? Why would a person go through the extent to try to make people? Somebody said that the reason why she might have done this is for the simple fact that being a natural Caucasian woman, based in trying to set some kind of, trying to reach a certain pinnacle in what professional career, could you have used what you used in college with white folks? You understand? So, you have to ask yourself, when we look at also, when we look at when you look at videos and they talk about Obama, and they say how it's kind of hidden mystery as to how he was groomed and how he was educated and who brought him in. Now, let me go on a little bit further with it, right? This Dozal, right, is German, right? German Scandinavian is what her parents who outed her, right? And it's, and a lot of people are questioning why did the parents outed her, based on what I've read and what they so-called stated was no one had ever asked her before, because what she was doing was keeping them away from being publicly seen with question about her ethnicity and her authenticity, right? So she stays away from her mother and father. She marries a black man, right? Somehow it is also stated that I think the parents, I'm not sure, maybe I have to go back and recheck again, that those brothers and sisters were adopted. And so when the reporter who ran up on her asked her about who was this and you claiming this to be your father, and then when he pondered the question on you, are you African American, she was halted like a thunderbolt struck her. Like, the gig is up. Now the point is, who lifted the gig? You understand what I'm saying? Who the one said it's time to reveal her? Now, again, I'm not going to dwell on her because it is what it is. Everybody sees it, right? And what more can be said here? Infiltration in all organizations, if you don't believe that they happen, then you misinform. You really don't understand the game. Every organization has been infiltrated. Every, yes, even yours, listen to me, even yours have been infiltrated. They have to have that information. It cannot be two kingdoms cannot stand in one. You understand? And he has to surveillance you. Everything is being surveillance these days. Everything is being listened to. Everything is being under the microscope. You understand what I'm saying? So, you know, you have to look at the fact that this woman, who is she working for? Well, again, her parents and her are Germans, right? And the organization she's working for, that a lot of people assume that it's a black organization, but it was actually founded by and funded by Jacob Schiff. Now, how many of you know about who Jacob Schiff is? Okay? Now, Jacob Schiff, historically, for those who've done their research, and I'll just give you a little bit as into it. Accordingly, Schiff had done too badly for himself. Okay? He was really wealthy. And he was actually a partner. Well, when he purchased with the Rothschild gold, back in the early 1900s, right? 1902, I think. Or 1900, 1904, right? All right? And so, what he did with a lot of his money that he accumulated, is he achieved undisputed control over the transportation, the communication system, supply lines in the United States, and has been proved control these in absolute essential for successful revolutionary efforts in any country. The cat that funded the NAACP, when you look at historically, you will find out that he helped the revolutionary movement in Russia. And the things he was setting up and what he was purchasing helped to set up all those revolutions when we look at the French Revolution. Huh? See, y'all don't know who y'all dealing with, man. Y'all think y'all know, right? We even talk about the American Revolution. We even talking about how they now some people may not gonna like this what I'm about to say. You know, when they said that Haiti whooped the French, right? They said that how Haiti whooped the French, right? And they whooped the world power. I'm not saying that they didn't whoop the world power. Don't get me wrong. What I'm saying is that the manipulation behind the scene that transpired was that the fact that there was a manipulation distorting the French so that they could not win that war. You understand? It wasn't just there. They was in other places. They were fighting several wars. But this particular part is because they couldn't get the ammunition. And when you trace this historically, you'll find out who was controlling it. And they had the agenda to stop it. And they end up, that's how they lost. Because they could not fight them because they did not have the weaponry. Think about a world power that ain't got no weaponry. Huh? You ain't got no weaponry. You ain't got no ammunition. How you gonna win? And you on the land of somebody else when they outnumber you. So that's not to take anything away from the Haitians. It's just a simple fact that there was some manipulation behind the scenes. You understand? So when we looking at these pawns that work behind the scenes in society, she's a pawn. We have to look at the times we're in. We have to look at the fact that haven't we been noticing that somebody or something is continue throwing in our face events to make us or to entice us, to make us galvanize, to jump. You understand what I'm saying? There's things being manipulated, keep poking and prodding until they're going to figure out which event is going to get us to get into it. That's what they've been doing. They've been sensationalizing. Not that I'm saying that the events that is happening where police are doing things, are killing our people or harassing our people. I'm not saying that they're not worthy of news. But the continuous preponderance of it over and over and over again is trying to embed into the psyches of our people that what you gonna do? Huh? Do you know if there's any other people, especially white people, they would have been done, took to arms. So based on our demeanor and our mind state, we still stay in a prevalent position of anticipating. They're trying to invoke us, to entice us into something. So now they bring out this white woman is in the NAACP. They showed you what happened with the little girl in Texas, right? Where the police officer roughhouses it up. Roughhouse her up, and a young brother comes to aid to her. And then when you look at what they purported on the news, just like when you look at the last video I put out when I show your brother, when I talk about the stop plantation Negro syndrome, where the one young brother who made the video talking about how that particular cop didn't, who pulled him over, who only just kind of did it and went on about his way, right? So they get this sister, which I'm going to show y'all, and she gets on national TV right? I'm not going to judge this sister, but just listen.
Everyone has, or is in an uproar about, you know, they reframed the black kids and not the white kids. The white kids weren't running. The black kids were. Parents need to take ownership in what their children are doing and hold them accountable for their actions, as well as the parents should be held accountable.
That mother's video message going viral, more than 2 million views on the internet. She posted it to her Facebook page in response to the outrage over this video showing a Texas police officer pointing a gun and pushing a 15-year-old girl to the ground. He would, a couple days later, resign. Join us right now from Dallas, Texas, is that mother, Keisa Jackson. Keisa, good morning to you.
Good morning, how are you?
I'm doing okay. Why were you so troubled by the video that you felt like you had to hold your cell phone and make that video in the parking lot of where you work?
I was just upset at the situation. You know, these kids were out of control. You know, I never disputed that the officer was also, but he wasn't my concern. You know, these kids are our future, so...
Sure.
I was just upset that they did not know how to conduct themselves with the authorities. You know, it really bothered me. Like, their safety was in danger and they had no clue.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. But you also saying to the parents, come on, parents, do you know where your kids are, essentially?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we have to know where our kids are, but... Even when I was saying educate them, I was just basically saying just, you know, there have been a lot of, you know, police killings or, you know, kids being hurt, you know, when things aren't going right.
Sure.
And the parents aren't letting these kids know how to conduct themselves when those situations mm-hmm. occur. You know, that could have totally, I mean, it was bad, but it could have been so much worse.
Yeah.
Or it could have just been, you know, we saw an irate police officer and these kids are sitting there and then, you know, we really would have looked at him crazy.
No kidding. After you posted that and it's been seen by 2 million people, you got some great comments, very supportive. But then again, some people are really angry at you. Are you shocked at the threats?
They are. I'm very shocked at the threats. I mean, people are saying, you know, freedom of speech. These kids have the right to be there. They can voice their opinion. But you curse me, you know, call me out of my name and threaten my safety because I voiced my opinion. I don't get it.
Yeah, I don't either. You were just speaking your mind. And a lot of people
saw
that and they agreed with you. And, are you sorry you did it?
No, I'm not sorry. I don't take it back. I mean, you know, I have battled with it.
Yeah.
I spoke to my sons, and they were like, Mom, I'm in total agreement with what you're doing. I support you. Do not take the video down. So I didn't.
Absolutely not. It's a powerful message. Keisa Jackson joins today from Dallas. Ma'am, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now, based on what this sister just stated here, everybody is entitled to their opinion and their perception of what they believe. But if you listen to the conversation that she stated, she said a lot of things that make you wonder why you saying what you saying. Now, let's get to the crux of this, because you have some people who made videos that I've seen, because see, when things like this happen, I don't jump out right away. I try to let things marinate a little bit. There's more information that need to be done. I seen somebody who jumped out the window and totally just said some stuff about black people, which that's based, his whole foundation is based on belittling and appeasing to another crowd. You understand what I'm saying? Y'all might know who I'm talking about. But based on what was said is the fact that black people not parenting, the black kids didn't know how to adhere to authority. What nobody never stated was the fact that what started the whole altercation. That whole altercation was set upon the fact that, according to the video that I seen, that substantiate the fact that what I'm about to say, was that some white people who did not like basically the children being at the pool had a confrontation with one of the teenagers and was reciting some racial slurs, to the fact that one of the girls stood up to defend and was trying to basically correct her on what she was saying, and it became into a, I won't say a fisticuff, but at least there was hair pulling. You understand? And so, based on the call from there, the police came. But the girl that got into the confrontation with the white person, the mother was there. And it was their pool party. Now, for some of the people who ever lived in a complex, they know that you can have a clubhouse and have guests come to the pool, right? Depending on the age, they're allowed to be able to go into that pool without any parental guidance, because they have a lifeguard present on the premise, right? Now, there's this old thing, matter of fact, I think it was in a movie with Dorothy Dandridge, or one of them, when she tried to get into the pool and they all jumped out of the pool when they were getting in, it was in Dorothy Dandridge as well, or Josephine Baker, one of them stories that did it, but also in the movie with Bernie Mac played as the coach. He played that. It was a swimming pool movie about brothers. Pride, I think the name of the movie was. And they got into the pool, and the white people got a pool, and they closed the pool down, right? That's what happened here. See, they were saying that black people getting in there is affecting the damn pool, and so white people don't want to be in there because they're saying you bringing germs, as if they don't know their own damn history about how German they can be. You know what I'm saying? So anyway, for this woman to sit here and try to, you know, support when you said that if he would have shot when he pulled his gun out and killed, he'd have been more crazy than what he was. Well, if he was crazy from what he did prior to, why are you trying to, you know, commend that he was in the right? Or you said, well, I'm not saying he's not wrong, but the black children should have adhered to his authority. When you look at that video, and you realize that, one, he just went wild. He was, anybody that was of melanin, he accosted them. Now people say, well, the white people didn't run. Well, let me tell you something. What we've been seeing lately in the news, and you hear police coming, you see mama jumping out the car running, you won't be moving too. You ain't trusting them. It's only a natural instinct based on the evidence and facts that we have seen prevalent to get your ass out the way. Only the fool is going to sit there and take it. Now, he had a call. He's running to go to the call. How come they so far away from where they coming from to get to there? I didn't understand that part. Dude rolling and falling like he T.J. Hooker on one of them old 80s shows. You know what I'm saying? Joe Foster or something. Matter of fact, Beretta over the hood, or Starsky and Hutch over the hood. You know what I'm saying? So, I'm saying that they're using all of this to entice. And then they talk about, when we look at the list of names of people just in 2014, right? Let me give a little acknowledgement to a lot of the brothers who done failed. You know, we're going to start with, you know, Trayvon Martin was one, right? Then you got Dontre Hamilton. You got Eric Gardner. You got John Crawford. You got Michael Brown. You got Ezeal Ford. You got Dante Parker. You got Tanisha Anderson. You got Akaya Gurley. Tamir Rice. Romaine Brisbane. Jermaine Reed. Tony Robinson. Phillip White. Eric Harris. Walter Scott. Freddie Gray. Okay? Now, that was just in 2014, right? Then what about what we having of this year already, right? I seen a stat where it says about 1,000. There's been 1,000 police incidents with police with black people, right? So what is it that they're trying to entice? They're trying to make us, you understand, get into this fervent fire to retaliate. And so this infiltration here was already set there. She was used, and they were going to expose it at a time that they needed. And they've been, I mean, just go over the history lately, man. That's all they've been doing. There's been one thing after another, after another, after another. And then when you realize that the NAACP is founded by people, when historically, they use this organization as part of to overthrow and revolutionize the country. If you don't believe me, go do the research. I gave you the names. Go check out the Russian Revolution. Go look at the French Revolution, even the American Revolution. Go back and see how that was funded and how it was undermined and who was behind the causes of it. You understand? So, the times that is happening, right? So, with the times that we are seeing, as I showed you the clip, where in that parliament he was stating that there was 100 million Europeans were going to be gone in 40 years, right? 100 million, and he said this is the top priority for Europeans, right? This is the thing that they needed to have been focused on. As a matter of fact, he even stated that it was already too late for them. But they have been working diligently, trying to repopulate themselves. Okay? See, let me read you something about these. You know when they told us about Monsanto's, right? They told you about Monsanto's and, right? They told you about Monsanto's, and then they have partnered with Pfizer, right? And they came together to create, let me pull this up right quick, to create this. Now listen to this. Which makes breakthrough in genetically modified humans. You know I'm going to say that again. Which makes breakthrough in genetically modified humans. Cheney, Wyoming, after several years of research and copious testing, the Wyoming Institute of Technology, along with our partners at Pfizer and Monsanto, and with a sizable federal funding grant, are pleased to announce that in February of 2015, the world's first genetically modified humans will be born to the world. With data on the genetically modified organisms, or GMOs, supplied by our friends at Monsanto's, WITT researchers were able to create artificial, genetically modified sperm and use it to fertilize a donated female human egg. Using in vitro fertilization, that egg has successfully been placed within a female patient who will carry the world's first GMH to term. Her expected due date is February 8, 2015. Our research in GMH technology began in December of 2009. Few months after the Obama administration lifted the ban on scientific research involving human embryonic stem cells. The theory, piloted by members of our senior research team, concluded that the human genome could be modified using existing GMO technology to create what WITT is calling an alpha human, using physical and psychological traits that we believe would make up a perfect human. If the child is born without complications, our pioneering research in the fleshly invented field of GMH technology could revolutionize the way we, as a race of beings, evolve through future generations. Imagine a world where humans are immune to every disease, are guaranteed to live past 100 years of age, or possibly forever, and never succumb to all the ill effects of aging. With GMH technology, all this could be possible within 20 years. Meet the world's first alpha human. named Herbert Stanley T. Alpha 001, will be the world's first alpha human, with physical and mental traits far superior to those of most contemporary humans. Herbert will be a Caucasian male, growing to exactly 6 feet 0 inches in height. On his 21st birthday, he will be 16% stronger physically than an average American. And laboratory data indicates he will have an OTIS gamma IQ test, or OTIS gamma IQ test, score of 133, making him eligible for membership in Mensa. He will also be immune to most forms of cancer and will be 23% more resistant to most other illness than an average American. Currently, our understanding of the human genome is limited, but Herbert is designed to make the best use of the information we do have on hand. And with his frequent lab visits over the course of his lifetime, our researchers will be able to create future generations of alpha humans who far exceed our wildest expectations for this program. Alpha humans, right? Alpha humans. You remember there was a show that came on not too long ago. They were talking about the alphas, right? They had the Indian girl, they had the white boy, had another white boy, right? And they had the one brother, and all he was strong, right? Malik Yobo, I think was his name, right? So there's now, based on if you watched that show, you've seen how the different abilities they had, right? And so they're stating that now, when I read that, now I showed you in prior videos when they talk about we are Americans, they're talking about white people, 16%. Stronger physically than the average American, the average white person. You understand what I'm saying? So this is the replacement to try to have longevity with this white race. They're using science to clone themselves, okay? But you're saying, well, how is that possible? If they're using white genes with white genes, it's still going to produce a sickly individual. Well, check this out. First genetically altered babies. You know, I'm going to say that again. First genetically altered babies. Researchers in New Jersey claim that 30 human babies might have been born with genes from three people: their mother, their father, and their third person, whose genes were added in the laboratory. The researchers called the experiment the first case of human genetic modification resulting in normal, healthy children. The term at the Institute for Reproductive Medicine and Science of St. Barnabas in West Orange, New Jersey, was trying to help infertile women become pregnant. In each of the 30 cases, something in the mother's egg had prevented her from conceiving naturally. So St. Barnabas researchers extracted material from cells donated by a third woman. This additional material from the donor cell somehow allowed the egg to become fertile. Their first success of having a child born with this cellular transfer technique was published in a medical journal in 1997. But an analysis of the genetic consequences of the method in two babies was only reported in March. In the journal Human Reproduction, DNA tests on two of them show they have a small number of genes that are not from their parents. The genetic status of the other 28 babies is unknown. The different genes come from DNA containing mitochondria, little organs inside cells that create the energy to do life's work. They contain DNA, only about 0.03% of the total DNA. So they can make copies of themselves when cells divide. The other 99.97% of the cells' DNA come from the nucleus and the 23 pairs of chromosomes. A number of scientists questioned of the ethics of the experiment. For the first time, they say it has been confirmed that children have been born with genetic alterations. So I had made a video that a lot of you didn't even go look at. I made a video that y'all didn't even look at, but they make sure nobody don't see it. I talked about the Frankenstein, and how he was using and genetically modifying the humans, huh? The human genome project. Who you think they using? Whose DNA are they using? Trying to supply the deficient European white man. Who gene could they use to enhance their own? Been studying the black man genes or the black people genes. Infusing their genes, trying to create this clone white man on the outside with somewhat of a foundation of a black gene without showing the outward appearance of the Negro inside him. Huh? They're doing all this work trying to prevent the numbers from falling. And so going back to when they were talking about this Aryan and this superior race, this is what they're trying to do. Matter of fact, right? When you think about it, this cloning stuff, that's what they're doing, trying to make this soldier, right? This super soldier. Remember that movie with Kurt Russell in it? Hmm? And what end up happening is because you're using three people, there's a possibility that some of them genetics of that third person is going to resonate in this, and there's a possibility it to fall into that. It's kind of like what Kurt Russell did, right? He was under this clone in mind structure and you know what I'm saying, and this whole thing, and end up reverting back to the human aspect of it and end up being the one fighting against it. Because it's never foolproof. You understand what I'm saying? It's never foolproof. So this trying to create a super alpha white man, right? Because they said if a cataclysm is to happen and they can't get this where all this is going to work, this is what they're saying. They're trying to go to Mars. Hmm? And they talking about the technology that, remember in the clip that it said this man said that he was building this space program for the simple fact so that he could preserve, you know what I'm saying, preserve his people and take millions to people to Mars. Now, how many black people, how many of you want to be on that list? Huh? There's some out here, they probably never listened to my video, but they out here. And they want to be on that list. But again, accordingly, something was stated about what's going to happen. I don't know. Now, it said moon, but wherever you going, it's going. See, that's the whole thing. They trying to run, but ain't nowhere to hide. So they thinking that they going to get up out of here and they're going to get up and go to Mars and that's going to be the end of it. But let me tell you something. Before that even going to happen, based on what's going on down here, when we see the signs, right? As you've seen in that clip, you've seen this red sun. Pure red sun. Never seen before. No one talked about it. Everybody act like it didn't even happen. Because it's like an omen. But an omen to who? It is a sign of the times. And the signs of the time, you've seen the weather. You've seen the mindset of the people. You've seen the fear in those other people. And these signs is making this cataclysm that is going to bring about this clash of the titans. This war that's about to take place. So isn't it ironic that Michael Jackson got with Vincent Price? And if you listen to the lyrics that Vincent Price is stating, he is talking about that event. As I surely pieced it together to show you. Now, what are we to look at all this? Are we to look at this and think that, well, this is a lot of spook ooga booga? I know y'all be writing that, doing that spook ooga booga, right? You say all that all you want. And that's the problem with some people. They think they got the answer, that they got everything covered. when you looked at the project here, it said 99.97, right? So there's still a 0.03% chance. Wesley Snipes said it best. Always bet on black. Now, Mr. Blow Your Mind, coming with a short synopsis to this little scenario. And I'm your whiteologist. I ain't telling you what I heard, y'all. I'm telling y'all what I know.
No, let's ask the white man. Yeah, he knows. He's related to them.
Yeah, Whitey, why is everything?
Yeah, Whitey, why is it that way?
I'm sorry, you're going to have to take the heat.
For all of the evils that white people have
all
laid.
All I can say is, we're vindictive because you stole our pigment.
Darkness falls across the land. The midnight hour is close at hand. Creatures crawl in search of blood to terrorize your neighborhood. And whosoever shall be found without the soul for getting down must stand and face the hounds of hell and rot inside a corpse's shell. The demons squeal in sheer delight. It's you they spy, so plump, so right. For though the groove is hard to beat, yet still you stand with frozen feet. You try to run, you try to scream, but no more sun you'll ever see. For evil reaches from the crypt to crush you in its icy grip. The foulest stench is in the air, the funk of 40,000 years, and grisly ghouls from every tomb are closing in to seal your doom.